Now in this video, we'll get some hands-on experience with EC2, we'll start an EC2 instance, and most importantly, we're going to connect to it and then install extra software, change some permissions, some settings, so that you see what can be done with EC2, and so that you get a real example for working with EC2, in this case, to run a web server which serves this website, which allows us to enter and save and view data, which is based on this code, which you of course find attached to this video, with help of AWS EC2. Now we'll use EC2 and start a virtual server in this video. And you should definitely watch all the other EC2 videos first, because I do expect that you know what EC2 is in general and what core EC2 features like AMIs or instance types are all about. Now, one quick note, if you don't know what AWS EC2 is and which core features it has and how it generally works, or if you're not really familiar with AWS at all, you might want to check out my AWS Cloud Practitioner course, which teaches you AWS from the ground up and even helps you pass your first AWS certification, in case you're interested. Now, the code for the website, which we're going to deploy, is attached to this video. It's stored on GitHub, and there it's in this dynamic website basic folder. Now, this code is written in JavaScript, and it uses Node.js to spin up a web server and the Express library to handle incoming requests and listen for requests on various routes. As part of this application, we're also using a file, datastorage.json, which is expected to be in this folder in the root file system of your device. And we use that file to store data and to retrieve data. In another video, we'll also use a database. Here, we'll use that file though. Now that's the application, the website code. And there's one important note regarding this file here and that path. Because we're using that file in that path for data storage and retrieval, you'll not be able to run this website locally on your system unless you create that file and fill it with the right content in that /demo/data path. Now we will create that path and file as part of this video because I want to show you how you could do things like that on an EC2 instance, because we'll also have to work with some Linux permissions when it comes to that. But I just wanted to let you know that running this website on your local system could fail for that reason. But the code isn't too important right now anyways. Instead, we want to deploy that code. So here I am in my AWS account. And of course, we want to go to the EC2 service page to launch a new EC2 instance. Now, in this video, I do expect that you know what EC2 is generally about and what all these different settings here are all about. If you don't know what these things are all about, you might want to check out my Cloud Practitioner course, where I do explain AWS and also this service from the ground up. This video here is there to help you get some hands-on experience with AWS. So here we're launching a new instance. As the AMI, which defines our base operating system and software, I'll choose Amazon Linux and I'll keep the default settings. Very important, it's free tier eligible, which means that if we're in the first 12 months after creating this account and we don't exceed certain quotas, we can start and run this server for free. But you should check out the AWS pricing pages for all the details. And with that, we can choose a hardware profile. That's what the instance type is all about. With it, we choose a hardware profile. There's a long list of hardware profiles we could use, but for this demo, I'll choose this T2 micro instance, which is also free tier eligible, which is of course not very powerful, but good enough for this demo. Now, I won't add a key pair because I won't connect to this instance from my local laptop. We would need a key pair for that if we would want to connect from our local machine via SSH to that instance once it's up and running, but I won't connect through my local laptop, so we don't need that. And for the network settings, we can keep the defaults here, especially regarding the VPC. However, I will edit the security group that's being created for us. Besides allowing SSH traffic, which I will allow even though I don't plan on connecting from my local laptop to the instance, but it will still connect to the instance in a different way, hence I'll keep that rule. But besides that rule, I'll also allow HTTP traffic because we are going to run a web server on that instance after all. Now we can keep the default storage here, we don't need more, and we also don't need to edit any advanced details. Instead, that is all we need to do, and with that, we can launch this instance. Now it takes a couple of seconds for the instance to be up and running, we can monitor it here, and once it is up and running, I'll connect to it, even though I don't have a key pair, and then we'll add all the software and settings on that instance that we need to add to finally run our web server on it. Now my instance here is up and running, and therefore we can select it and click connect. Now we could connect with a local SSH client from our local computer to that instance if we had a key pair. Then we could follow these steps here to establish a connection. But here in this case, I don't have a key pair and I don't need one because we can also use EC2 Instance Connect. This essentially allows us to connect to this instance via AWS own servers, so different servers than the one we started here. We can keep these default settings and click connect, and since we have SSH enabled on that instance with help of that default security group rule which we kept, since we have that enabled, we can establish this connection here in the browser. Now technically the connection is now not between our local computer and that instance, but instead it is between one of AWS computers somewhere in one of their data centers and our instance. But since we're connected to the AWS cloud through the management console, AWS gives us access to that terminal session which it established between its computer and the instance through the browser here. So therefore, here we got this terminal, and we can run commands here which will execute on our virtual instance. So this terminal here is connected to our EC2 instance, our virtual server. So in order to run our web server here, our Node Express web server on that instance, we must clone this code, which is on GitHub, onto that instance. Now we do this with git clone, but if we try this, we'll see that git is not installed. Therefore, we must install it, and thankfully, since we picked Amazon Linux, that's super simple because that comes with a package manager. Well, I guess all Linux distributions come with a package manager, but nonetheless, we can now run sudo yum update to make sure the package manager has all the latest references to packages we can install. And then we can install git by running sudo yum install git. And this now downloads and installs the git tool onto this instance. Can take a couple of seconds, but thereafter, git will be available. With that done, we can grab this cloning URL. And now we can run git clone and use this URL. If we do that, the code is downloaded. And now we got this AWS demos folder here into which we can navigate. In there, we find this dynamic website basic folder, maybe also a couple of other folders when you're watching this, but we need the dynamic website basic folder now. And in there, we find all the code files that make up our website. Now, in order to run that code and spin up that Node web server, we need Node.js installed. And just like Git, Node is not installed. This tool does not exist here yet. So we must install Node.js. Now, this can be done by executing a couple of commands. And actually, it's such a common thing to do that AWS has an official guide on how to install Node.js on an EC2 instance, and you find a link to that guide attached to this video. In the end, it's a couple of commands which we must execute. First, a command to download and install the NVM tool, the Node Version Manager tool, which helps us install Node.js. Then, as a next step, we must activate that tool, basically. And then we can install the LTS, the long-term stability version of Node.js, or any other version we want to, with help of the NVM install command. In this case, NVM install --LTS to install that LTS, that long-term stability version. Now that Node.js is installed, we can come back here into our project folder, I actually never left it, and can run npm install to install all the dependencies this code needs. And once these dependencies have been installed, we can run the web server by running node app.js, but we won't do that yet. Remember that I mentioned that this line of code can be problematic if you try to run the code locally? Because we expect to have a slash demo data folder with a data storage JSON file inside of it? And that folder is not inside of our project folder, but instead in our root folder in our system. Therefore, as a first step, we must make sure that that folder and the data storage JSON file exists. To do this, we can create that folder with makedir -p /demo/data -p makes sure that all the missing folders are created. And we actually must add sudo here since we otherwise don't have the right permissions. Now we also need to run this command thereafter to create this data storage.json file with the appropriate content inside of it, with that JSON content. So once we execute this, that file will be created in that demo/data folder, which we created before. And now with that file in that folder set up, we will be able to run our web server, our Node.js application. At least almost. Right now, our application would actually fail if we tried to run it and then interact with it, because the node server that we're going to start, the node application that we're going to start, needs to interact with that file here. Now, since we connected to this instance with the EC2 user, this user does not out of the box have the appropriate permissions to interact with that file. That's why we had to add sudo all the time. Now, there would be different ways of creating that file and running that server, as a root user, for example, and we'll do it differently in other videos, but here, what we can do and what we should do is we should make sure that this user has appropriate permissions. For that, we can run sudo group add www to add a new user group, essentially, and then we add the EC2 user to that group with the user mod command. And after doing this, we log out with help of exit, because we need to reload this session here. So we need to connect to the server again through EC2 Instance Connect so that these changes take effect. And then thereafter, we pass ownership of that /demo/data folder by running the change ownership command like this, actually with help of sudo, since we need permission to change that ownership. We then change the permissions of the demo folder such that the EC2 user is able to write into it and not just read from it, because the node application, which will be executed by the EC2 user in the end, since we will start it, must be able to also write to the file in that demo data folder. And this command makes sure that we have appropriate write permissions. And then thereafter, we execute these two commands, the find commands here, to also change the permissions on all the subdirectories and files to make sure that this user, and therefore the node application that will run through that user, has appropriate write permissions. Now, all these commands can be super confusing. You don't need to be a Linux administrator to work with AWS. We're doing this all in a very basic way here. In other videos, we'll choose a different route. But with these commands executed like this, we make sure that now we took all the steps needed to run this node application on this EC2 instance and run it such that it is able to interact with that data storage file, which sits in that root folder. Therefore, what we can do now is we can again navigate into this AWS demos folder and then there into this dynamic website basic folder. And in there, we can now run node app.js to run this node server. And it's up and running. But like this, it's not too useful actually. One problem we'll face with this application is that it listens on port 3000. But this port is not open on this instance. Instead, we only opened the ports 22 and 80. These are the only ports where we accept traffic. Now, we could have opened 3000, but 80 is the default HTTP port. Now, why don't we just change the port here to 80 and then redeploy that code? We could do this, but as a non-root user, we're actually not allowed to listen on port 80 on Linux systems. And in general, you might not want to have your node server listen on port 80. Instead, the more elegant solution here is to simply redirect traffic that reaches this instance here on port 80 to port 3000 internally. And that can be done if we cancel this node server with control C. That can be done by running this command, the IP tables command. This command adds an entry in the local internal IP table of that instance, so the internal routing table, that redirects traffic that's coming in on port 80 to port 3000. So our visitors, external users, still send a request to port 80 on that instance, but internally it will trigger port 3000 if we execute it like this. With that done, if we now rerun NodeAppJS, we will be able to send requests to that instance. Now for that, we need to inspect the instance details here, and then we need either the public IP address, which was assigned automatically, or the public DNS address, so a domain name that was assigned automatically by AWS. We can use this and send a request to that domain or IP. Now it might take a while initially, but thereafter we'll see this website here. And here we can share some statements, which is always a good idea in the internet. And once such a statement was shared, we can also visit it and of course share our opinion, which is even better in the internet because people have only great opinions there. And of course they always communicate in a super friendly way, right? So that's this website up and running with help of AWS and this EC2 instance. Now, as you can tell, we had to execute a couple of commands on that EC2 instance. Starting the instance was quite straightforward, but then we had to go through various configuration steps. Now, that was just one way of getting the code onto that instance and running that server there. It's not the only way, and in other videos we'll see other ways and how we can simplify this process. But actually, even though it might have looked a bit complex and it might be overwhelming to see all these Linux commands here, it shows one key advantage of EC2 actually. We can control everything. We have our own computer in the cloud and we can therefore configure it and install software on it just as we need to. We got full control over the software on the system, over the configuration, the users, the permissions. And that is what makes EC2 so powerful, because it's your computer in the cloud in the end. Now, to conclude this video, there's just one thing I want to change. I started this server here by running NodeAppJS, but the problem with that is that if I now close my connection here and I try to reload this, the website is gone because I canceled this process, which I started by running NodeAppJS. Of course, that's not how it should be. Therefore, I'll reconnect. And I can go back into my folder here and run NodeAppJS again, right? But I now have to keep my computer up and running as long as the website should be up and running. That's of course not ideal, and therefore a better solution instead of doing that is to install an extra tool which will run that server in the background. For example, the PM2 tool, which we can install with npm install pm2 at latest-g to install it globally. This will install this tool on this machine. And PM2 in the end is just a tool that we can use to start our node server, but in the background, so that we can safely close this terminal here, this session. Once it is installed, we can run PM2 start app.js. And now this starts the node server in the background. We can type other commands here and we can close this session. And despite it being closed, if I reload this website, it's still there. Our data is of course also still there because we did not terminate the instance in between. Speaking of that though, now with the demo finished, we can of course terminate that instance to make sure we're not paying for any resources we don't need, even though here we're inside of the free tier, but still. And we can recreate it whenever we need to. Of course, our data would be lost, but we'll take care about that in another video.